Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Deborah Hughes, Assistant Director of Publicity and Publications at DAS, and I'll be your host along with the head of DAS International, Anaberta, Oehlers-Jaen.
Thank you for attending today's webinar on supporting third culture kids with learning differences, something that is very close to my heart as all of my children have experienced this growing up here in Singapore. Before we start this webinar, a bit of housekeeping.
Your experience of this webinar is as good as your internet connection and your device. So if you're experiencing any technical difficulties, you can just leave the webinar and re-enter, and hopefully that will solve your problems. You have control over the volume, so you can adjust that on your own device. If you have questions for the presenters, please click on the Q&A icon at the bottom of the window, the Zoom window, and type in your questions there. Or you can simply chat with us in the chat function. We'll collect your questions and hope to provide answers as we go along during the webinar, or we will attend to them at the end at the Q&A section. If we don't have enough time today to answer all your questions, we will endeavour to answer them and we will publish them on our website, and we'll alert you to that by email. And we'll do that as soon as possible after the webinar. So let's get started. I'd like to introduce you to our panel, who will be sharing with us today. From Cambodia, we have George Cowie, Director and Founder of the Learning Support Asia. George has had 20 years of experience teaching in international schools and supports students with dyslexia in multilingual learning settings. From Thailand, we have Harshi Sema, a school principal and the founder of the Village International Education Center. Harshi has over 20 years of experience teaching and supporting students with learning differences, and he has made strong partnerships with international schools in Thailand. From Indonesia, we have June Athens, an educator and parent from the Binus School in Simbrug, Jakarta. June has nearly 20 years of experience teaching, and her own children are third culture kids with learning differences. And from Singapore, we have Shilpa Madan, a senior specialist teacher with DAS International. Shilpa has a wealth of information supporting students from international schools and with learning differences, and understands the challenges that these students face as third culture kids. And joining me today as host, co-host and moderator is Anaberta Oehlers-Jaen. Anna has been supporting students with dyslexia and other learning differences for over 16 years now, and as head of DAS International, she aims to provide a professional service to the specific learning differences committee, both in Singapore and in the region. Anna, over to you. Is Anna with us today?
Yes, I am.
Good.
Yes, how's everyone today? Thank you, Deborah. Thank you so much for the introduction and a warm welcome to all our participants here in Singapore and overseas for this year's World Dyslexia Awareness International Forum. This is the second time we're doing the International Forum. The forum this year will be on supporting third culture kids with learning differences. So I'm your host and your moderator for today for the next hour and a half, along with my co-host Deborah. So we thank you so much for making the time today, and we have an exciting lineup of panelists from the region. They're all very active in their fields. Thank you so much, dear panelists, for accepting our invitation today. So I know that y'all are also very excited to share with us. So together with our panelists, really who span across various countries, it is our hope that through this discussion and the sharing of the direct experiences in supporting third culture kids, and some of them actually have third culture families within them, and they've been supporting families with learning differences. So we hope to take away through this discussion, really for everyone to have a further understanding of their strengths, you know, their challenges, strategies that we could, you know, all share so that we can support further our third culture kids. Yeah, so today's agenda will see just a varied presentations by our different panelists. I will start off with a bit of a definition, really, of what third culture kids are, so we are more or less on the same page. George will go on then to share about problems, opportunities for third culture kids with additional support needs. Hashi will share on supporting third culture kids. June will be talking about the benefits and challenges of being a third culture kid. And Shilpa talks about what happens when they move back home. So in between each of the discussion, we will have a panel discussion after each panelist has shared. Please, as Deborah has mentioned, do type in your questions so we can you know, have a try and reply to your questions. Yeah, next slide, please. So before we actually begin, we really found this really very, very nice video that was put up by Mount Kiara International School by their students who are, you know, third culture kids. So without further ado, shall we play the video?
So I think as a third culture kid, when you're constantly moving around, you often feel very alone and you feel that no one understands you and that no one understands what you're experiencing. I'm 15 years old and I'm from Brazil.
I was born in Malaysia.
Houston, Texas.
I was born in Quito, Ecuador, but I was raised and my family is from Oakland, California.
Then I moved to China, where I lived for 7 years.
And then I moved to KL.
I was born here in KL.
I've been to Singapore for 2 years, then I've been to Malaysia for 2 years, and then I went back to Bangladesh for 4.5 years.
I was born in Hanover, Germany.
Then moved to Germany and lived there for 3 years.
And then from KL, I moved to Singapore. And from Singapore, I moved to Islamabad.
My mom is Malaysian and my dad is French.
My mom is from Namibia and my dad is German.
My dad is Pakistani. My mom was born and raised in the US.
I have been traveling around for a very long time of my childhood.
I guess this is what my life is gonna be. I'm gonna be moving around all the time.
I feel like they don't understand me sometimes. I just felt like I was so different to everyone else.
They're dealing with a lot of emotions way earlier than some kids would.
It's become a part of me whether I like it or not.
I'm not really sure which culture I'm in.
He's from the US, he's from Europe, he's from Asia, you know, just we all sort of clicked with each other.
I met people that totally just challenged the way I had thought before. I'm afraid to miss a moment
where I'm free. Usually by default, I just say American. But then at the same time, I really think culture isn't a lot just an identity. And I think no one's really true cultured anymore.
That's kind of the whole point of being a third culture kid, is you're constantly on the move.
Being able to adapt quickly to new situations and different places.
Everybody knows that they're gonna leave at some point.
And I just want to let everyone know that there are people like you around the world and you are not alone.
You're forced constantly out of your comfort zone. Getting exposed to cultures, holidays that you didn't know existed, people that you didn't know existed, all of these things really help shape your own view of the world.
My first day in school in Germany was horrifying. It was probably one of the worst days of my life so far. I just had to just figure out everything at once.
I remember someone saying once to me, like, to pick a race. They're like, just pick a race, pick one. Like, your four things, just pick one. Like, I can't pick one.
Where is home? I'm starting to believe that it is gone. 'Cause I don't find it, though I'm looking.
So the video you just saw really was a snapshot into the project that the Third Culture Kids did. It's actually a 30-minute video. So we've shared the full length of the video, you know. So let's get on with it and, you know, let's dive in. So Third Culture Kids now, when I looked at looking at this topic, and I was reading a really good book, and I would really recommend it for anyone who really wants to know, like have a good understanding, you know, of everything. I would highly recommend Third Culture Kids, Growing Up Amongst Worlds, written by David Pollock and Ruth Raken. And this is like the third edition. And from my understanding, actually the word Third Culture Kid, actually it's something that has been around since the 1950s. It's not a new name, you know, and what's really surprising is that this came about from a sociologist, as I read in the book, who actually went over with her husband to India, and they went there, Rita. She actually went there to look at how the Americans, you know, different professionals there were actually integrating vice versa with the locals. And what she found in particularly interesting for her was actually the children of the expat kids. She found them quite interesting, and she coined that phrase, Third Culture Kids. And back then she defined them as simply children who accompany their parents to another culture. That was the simple definition, because back then they were Americans and they would just, you know, be going there. However, we have then in 1989, David Pollock, he redefined this acronym of Third Culture Kids. And to quote him, and it's the current definition at this time, is that a third culture kid is a person who has spent a significant part of his or her developmental years outside the parents' culture. So the TCK, Third Culture Kids, they build relationships to all of the cultures while not owning the culture. So although elements they take, you know, from each culture would be in their life experience, and they get the sense of belonging from that place that they're in. And this is how more or less they live and they form their relationships. And a lot of times they keep moving to different countries within a span of maybe 10 years. So children from countries like Europe, the US, Canada, Australia, India, and more, they can spend part of their school years in international schools across the globe. You know, mostly the schools actually are very, very good, and they do offer a wide extracurricular activities as well, and solid curriculum. So the broader experience and varied experience developed, and they even get to be exposed to bilingualism. They mold them to attain like a citizenship of the world, and they get to be coined as global citizens as well, of the culture kids, through this exposure. But however, it's not always easy for them. And this is more so if the child has a learning difference. That's why I think we are having this sharing today. So they are not, we have a melting pot of ethnic cultural diversity. And so the kids have a lot of choices, and typically kids with no learning difference find it a challenge if you read the literature in actually moving. So what more a child with a specific learning difference like dyslexia, ADHD, dyscalculia, all that gets in their way as well. So sometimes they feel powerless, and the family make that decision to move, okay? So they lose their sense of belonging, recognition. So we do have international schools that support students with learning differences. So what I'd like today is, through the various discussions, we try and understand how our panelists today, what they think, you know, of that kind of support, and maybe give us suggestions as well. So let's dive straight in with George. who's our first panelist, who'll share about problems and opportunities for third culture kids. Go ahead, George.
Thank you, Anna. Good afternoon, everyone. I just wanted to say a little bit more about my background. I spent the last 10 years working as a sort of SENCO learning support coordinator type roles in a few different international schools in different countries. My own son, therefore, is, you know, has been for most of his life a third culture kid as well. And this is a topic that is very dear to me and very close to me. So there are problems, potential problems, but there's also potential opportunities, you know, if you're moving to a different culture or, you know, considering that. And, you know, for students who have learning difficulties. I'll touch on a couple of issues that I have experienced, well, that I've noticed some students experiencing from my own personal background. So looking at academic issues, like specific learning difficulties, such as dyscalculia and dyslexia, often most definitions of these types of issues rest on a persistent difficulty despite there having been well-founded, well-researched interventions. So the student continues to have these issues despite the fact that they've had several interventions that have proven to be successful in the past. So from my point of view, you know, quite often I've had students refer to me in international schools saying, oh, we think this child is dyslexic, or we think that he has dyscalculia. And when I go to look at the admission, or when I went to look at the admission information, there wasn't anything there to document that well-founded interventions had taken place. So that's the first issue, the first, you know, problem that I've noticed a lot of students having. You know, people automatically go to that discussion about there's a specific learning difficulty, but we don't know whether it's just that they haven't actually, you know, been receiving teaching to, you know, that would normally remove that possibility. So whether it's actually a remedial, you know, a problem that that requires remediation, or whether it's actually something that we're looking at long term, which can have, you know, in primary school, very young primary school, obviously those are the times that are ripe for intervention. But if it's later primary school and they're moving into secondary school and the problem persists, then it can become a big issue. So that's one potential problem, and I'll come back to it later. The other potential issue is, particularly if you're moving countries and schools quite a lot, is that social communication issues, such as dyslexia or executive function issues common among autism, I meant to say, ADHD, you know, executive function issues, quite often these can be masked and just viewed as settling in issues, you know. So as a student moves to a different country, particularly, again, you know, as they start to get older and, you know, the teachers notice that they're having social problems in the classroom or issues with friendships and making friendships and things like that, that can mask or can be misinterpreted as a specific learning difficulty as well. So that's just something to be aware of. The video that we just saw at the start there, that, you know, a lot of the students, particularly if you watch the full version, a lot of the students describe settling in issues. And, you know, it's really difficult unless you have a record of needs that the school can refer to, like how they're going to interpret that, you know. So just to be aware of that. And as parents, you might be tempted you know, as you move from one school to another, if one school has been going through some issues with your student, or sorry, with your child, trying to work out, you know, whether it's actually a learning difficulty or whether it's just a, you know, circumstantial issues that are leading to these difficulties, then you might be tempted to not inform the next school. You might want to just leave the issues behind. And I'm sympathetic to that, because some schools do get it wrong. Some schools do focus on a child deficit sort of model. And it's a fact of life, I'm afraid. You know, most schools would not admit to that, but some of them actually do. I'm not here to give you specific advice about whether you want to leave that information behind or not, but it's something that I would understand, but something that I would warn against as well, up to a point. I mean, we have to assume that you are the expert, the ultimate expert on your child. You know, we're all trying to figure out parts of a picture, but you'll have a better idea of the whole than any of us. But the chances are that if you're moving location and you're moving to a new culture, a new country yourself, you're going to have an awful lot of issues that you'll be dealing with, just practical things like apartments, internet, contracts, new jobs, all those sorts of things. And it's going to be difficult for you to really keep a close eye on how your son or daughter is settling in. So, you know, if you're aware of issues before, from before, really, you know, you might. I would recommend either doing what I've just said would be difficult to do, to keep a very close eye on how they're settling in, or, you know, talk to the people at the new school about this ahead of time. Particularly, you might find it difficult to find a school that's sympathetic. Some international schools, nearly all of them, say that they're inclusive and they try to be inclusive, but you know what an inclusive school looks like in your, particularly if you're coming from your home country, if you're coming from a country that has the resources of the state behind it to try and make inclusion happen. If you're coming from a place like that and you're going to an international school, they won't necessarily have all of those resources available to you, you know, and that's where the organizations like Hershey's Village and the Dyslexia Association can become, you know, and how I strive to become as well. I'm quite new to this as a private business provider, but, you know, I'm aware of the needs because I've worked with organizations like DAS and the Village in different contexts. It can be, you know, hugely useful to you, and I strive to become as useful as these guys are as well. That's something else that you can consider if you're moving to a new location. Look at what other service providers there are. You know, you can be proactive about that yourself as a parent, you know. I wanted to mention as well something that I think we've all become more used to than we would have planned to over the last couple of years. But if you are moving location, you know, it's much easier these days to keep in touch with therapists and tutors that have been helpful, you know, in the past from the home country or from the previous country. You can keep that relationship going. You know, I myself have students that I used to have in Singapore, they're now in Australia. I've been working with them. Students that, you know, in Korea, student, you know, I've got quite a lot of international students that I've worked with in the past, and now they moved. And, you know, in the olden days, that would have been it, pretty much. But, you know, it's great to be able to keep that relationship going, to be able to provide information, details to schools and teachers and things like that about the previous interventions that have been useful for the students in the past. I think I think that's pretty much what I have to say just now. I'd be very interested to take any questions from anybody. A big part of the job that I, you know, used to do the Senko type positions in international schools was considering applications that were given to me by the admission department, you know, can we provide the support that this student requires. Quite often that's a judgment call that I've had to make on the data available to me. So, you know, if you're applying to schools and your son or daughter has a specific learning difficulty, if you want to pick my brain at all about the kind of thought processes or the types of considerations that a school makes before offering a position, I'd be happy to answer.
Thank you. Thank you, George, for your insightful background to the whole overview of TCK kids with learning differences. I just want to maybe, because we have a lot of topics, but this in you mentioned about admission testing, you know,
yes.
You had shared earlier, may or yep. may not occur at all international schools. It's not like a standard. So perhaps maybe June, maybe could you share a little bit further on you know, how necessary it is to have a background or assessment.
Right. I think admissions testing is necessary because it helps us, it helps the school to learn more about their potential students. But on the other hand, schools also need to think about the kind of testing that they do and what purpose it serves. Admissions testing can be a great way to collect data, to better prepare the school to support the students. But how is it conducted? Written exam suffice, but schools also need to take into consideration, this is a child who has moved to a new geographical location. He might be feeling anxious, not just about being in a new building. There will be tons of questions in his head about who's going to be my teacher, will people be able to accept me? So how can the school accommodate in their testing? Will a pen and paper kind of testing be enough? Will there be someone from the counseling department who will be involved? Things like that. What kind of accommodation? And another thing is, like, most of these admissions testing are facilitated by school administrators who may or may not be teachers. So what do they do with the data? Well, it will be great if, you know, the admissions department collaborate with all the different people in the school. So it's not just, you know, one part of the school who's looking into it. It's a collaboration of many different people to actually help a third culture kid coming into the school.
Touching on that point about sharing of the data, you know, and maybe, I mean, I'm sure for learning support at school that I've interacted with, they then come up with an IEP, right, for an individual education plan for the child. Shilpa, could you share? Because we develop a lot of IEPs.
Yeah. Can I just say something before we go into that?
Sure.
I think one of the things I often advise parents is when they're going to international schools when they're applying first, is often to ask the question, is there an admissions test or is it an entrance test?
Yeah, okay, it's different. Yeah.
Ask a good question to ask, and will that determine whether my child is offered a place or not? And you should do that before you do anything else, of whether you were in terms of entry or putting a deposit down or whatever you need to do. But it's the important question, and schools should be open and honest. As George mentioned in his talk, schools need to be honest and open about what these assessments are. And it's, sometimes they're ambiguous.
Sure.
Exactly. And, you're right.
And
very
even
much
more so in the field that we're in, we're talking about children with specific learning difficulties. And George is right. Some schools, if they hear that, they will not accept the child. So parents will be cagey and not wanting to offer that. But what we need is more transparency. We need more openness. We want to listen to the parents and also to the children, and so we can help them better.
Mm. So openness is one of the key themes, right? That parents should take away.
Yeah. Yeah. Sure. Sorry. Do you mind if I just say one more thing about that as well, please, Anna? I used to be, you know, because actually I taught for 10 years in the UK before, you know, working abroad. And so I came from that context, and all my like sort of training and qualifications are about inclusive education and trying to make inclusion happen. So from that point of view, I used to be against admission testing. I thought it was a bad idea. I thought, you know, but actually my practical experience of particularly working in a school that started off without admission testing, but then introduced it. One thing that I did notice was that an issue that we had prior to admission testing happening, or as you say, was it enrollment testing, Harshi? I'm not too sure about the distinction about that. Maybe we can come back to that. So.
We call it entrance. Some of them call them entrance exams.
Okay. And what is the distinction, if you don't mind me asking?
An entrance exam is quite specifically, they will only accept if you get a certain score, you'll be offered a position. So you're basically, you're excluding on the basis of that.
But okay. Harshi, can I step in to ask at these entrance exams, knowing if they know the background, the kid needs extra time, will they give them the extra time to sit for that extra exam?
It depends on the school, but if a child comes with some documentation that they have a specific learning difficulty, then yes, some schools will, some schools won't, if they won't recognize it. George, this is sort of, from the UK, we would have what we call 11 plus exams.
I don't think they do 11 pluses anymore though, do they?
No, I know, that was the old system. They would assess these children at that age to see if they were whether they'd be allowed into certain schools.
Yes, definitely.
And unfortunately, that's been adopted a little bit on international level.
Yes, yeah. Just coming back to my point, you know, prior to these tests being introduced at the school that I'm thinking of, you know, quite often we would get new students and they would come in and we would see, okay, they're having we wouldn't even pay that much attention, to be honest, because, you know, there were so many kids coming in at the start of the year or whatever. But, you know, it wouldn't be until a few weeks down the road often that then issues would emerge. And then we would be finding that, for example, you know, like students that have problems with literacy, or, you know, students that are having problems with behavior and settling in and things like that, you know, we'd be getting referrals for support, and we just wouldn't have the resources to be able to do that, you know. And admission or entrance testing, you know, can sort of nip that in the bud. And I've now changed my perspective that it's actually an example of sort of due diligence, you know, that you shouldn't really admit somebody unless you've done something like that. The Council for International Schools, I've worked on accreditation committees with them before, and they have their sort of statement of inclusion. It doesn't use the word inclusion, but it does say that at the point of admission, the school is certain that it can offer the support that the student requires to meet their learning needs, you know, throughout something like that. And yeah, I think that is only fair if you're going to take student, you know, parents' money, fees, and, you know. I've now come around to the idea that you've got to be sure that you can meet those needs, or that you can provide the support that's required.
True. And yeah, all this background information, like what Hershey and George are saying, like admission tests and some kind of assessment. I think it's extremely valuable, especially I feel in case of our TCK, like third culture kids, because the background becomes important when we create an IEP, which Anna, you were asking me, and we don't move forward unless we create an IEP. And that IEP is based on the learning styles, the developmental milestones, you know, everything we come to know, like what are the interests of the child, the hobbies, interests, because at least for myself, I know that when I create an IEP, we all call them SMART targets, of course, we try to stick to them, but I do focus on self-esteem. I judge that, I mean, I observe the student for a couple of sessions and read all the whatever background I have, background information I have received, and then self-esteem and activities based on students' interests. And I have seen that that IEP is always more productive. So I think, yeah, so background information is extremely valuable, and especially if the child has moved countries, like George was saying, yes, we always have to be kind of on top of that. Yeah, it's never like just a change of school or, you know. So yes, and in DS, we are really like, we heavily rely on IEP, although it is just a reference document we say, but yeah, we tend to go beyond that at times. We change it, we alter it. But yes, IEP is the background information. And I think if there is an admission test, like George and Hershey was saying, it would be really great. And if that student comes to us for extra support, we have had a student before that. You remember, Anna? She was a boarding student from Malaysia.
Yes.
So yes, and I did intensive program with her. And it was very useful that, you know, all the background information, and we managed to get her into that school. She was sitting for, and the correct word Hershey used is entrance exam. That's what they said, Hershey. Yeah, they never said admission test. She was sitting for an entrance test and she managed to get into that school.
Yeah.
So, yes. Yeah.
I think what I just want to just sum this up. We have another, we're running out of time. We will run out of time.
But this section anyway.
Yeah. Anyway, I think you're talking about admissions and you know, but I think from the parents' point of view perspective, because for me, I speak with a lot of parents, and some of them, they're wherever in America or England, and they're coming to Singapore and they're looking for a school. Mm-hmm. And they have a kid with a learning difference, and they ask me, you know, can you recommend a school? And I always say I can't recommend a school, but I can share with you the schools that do offer various types of learning support. And what I found, maybe just to share a couple of just very, very short tips that maybe I give to parents and maybe you guys can take away, should you, you know, have parents or yourselves who are moving around and you want to generally look at what should you look for in a school that is going to support your child with learning differences. And I think, you know, I think what we could do is when you check in with the school, maybe do they have a trial day? I think having a trial day is very, very useful information, because that way the parent can get a direct feedback from their child was there for half a day or the full day. The parent can get the impression of how the school is towards their child. So I think interaction is really, really important. And as people, we can sense that kind of interaction rather than just emailing or over the phone. It's important to directly go into the school, visit the school, and to try and meet the learning support teachers.
Yes.
So when you meet the learning support teachers, it's different from meeting the classroom teachers. Yeah. They are also very, very important people. But the learning support teachers are the ones who will perhaps guide, you know, the child's program there. And so some learning support, some schools have a lot of learning support, you know, each level may have one, some may not have. So depending on what is the ratio there. So I think that's something that you know, the little bit that parents could take, and whether is the child able to accommodate their child based on the learning need that their child has, because every child is individual and unique, and their learning difference may not suit that school. Maybe they need a smaller school or a, you know, more of a community type, or yeah. So, and what's the student ratio? Yeah, so these are just some of the points that just came to me when I'm just advising with parents. Now, so let's move on. We have to move on. So Hashi, our next panelist, is going to look at the importance of the role parents and teachers play within the international schools community in supporting their TCK, you know, navigate. And Hashi is the principal and the founder of the Village International Education Center in Thailand. Amazing school. I visited Hashi's school a couple of years back. Hashi, over to you.
Thank you very much. George, I was in the same position as you. I used to look at Singapore and DAS and wish I could be like them. And we're slowly creeping up to emulate them. George, you'll get there too, I'm sure.
I hope so.
Anna, can you, when you are talking to parents, can you substitute the word community and use village-like school, please?
Oh, village school. Okay.
Village-like school.
And I tell them, if you're in Thailand, really help me. Look for a village school.
I'm the principal of a very small school in Bangkok. And like George mentioned, in terms of provision, when I arrived out here, there was very little in terms of special needs services in international, even in the international settings. I have a specific learning difficulty. I have dyslexia, and I could consider myself as a third culture adult. I was a third culture kid. I was born in India. I grew up in England. So I experienced a lot of the things that we're going to be discussing today. And also, some of the things that there was in the video you saw resonated quite in terms of with me that had happened to me. So I want to sort of really kick off about how do we support parents of third culture kids with a specific learning difficulty. And I know George has already mentioned the terms in terms of specific learning difficulty. And what I wanted to sort of look at that aspect, we're moving in terms of specific learning difficulties and dyslexia, we're moving away from the concept of calling it a difficulty. And we are now calling it a difference. And I wanted to look at whether we could apply that sort of similar model to children we are considering as third culture, and whether this culture could be considered as being positive and the experiences they have as being positive. I was talking to Deborah last week in terms of how these children live in this bubble and they need certain types of support, and you know, and sometimes they're naive, and there's things that they really do struggle with. And I empathized with some of the things that she had said, and because I have two children very similar, and they, some of the experiences they have not experienced in other cultures where they're going to end up going into a university or colleges. So there's a big learning curve that they have to go through. However, there are some positives for parents to look at, but also some of the things that they need to really to be aware of. And one of the things that we find that these children often say is that they're moving around a lot. They can't establish friendship groups. The parents really find it quite hard to support them because in terms of the learning styles and the parenting styles of these children may be going through. So the key concepts that we'll need to look at is how do parents support their children? What rules and boundaries and structure are they giving their children? How are they helping their children gain a sense of identity, the nurturing aspect if their children are young? How are we then, how do we listen to the needs of the children? Now, there's a lot of work and research has been done, and Anna has already mentioned Pollock and Van Rinken, and they did a lot of research, and a lot of it was coming out of the missionary work that is being done going back to the, you know, from the early 50s. And the key areas that we want to look at and parents should be looking at is how can they help develop a sense of identity? How do they develop a sense of belonging? And it's a crucial element that these children what are saying, is that they say, who am I? Where is home? These all lead to a difficulty in some of the children saying, well, what is my culture? And parents can play a big role in how to help stabilize and support these children. And I know George, most of the people on that are discussing this panel have children, and we are going as parents going through this all the time. And it's not an easy task. As George people were saying, people have their jobs and they have to, you know, do a lot. Some of them are quite high power jobs and they have very little time, but it's time that they need to make. And that's an important aspect of discussing with parents, is that how do you make time for your children to guide them through some of and navigate through some of the pitfalls that they're going to face as third culture children. And what research shows us, and Pollock and Van Rinken mentioned this as well in their research, is that change can be good. And if it's managed right, and if we can support the children, we can get that right. And if teachers out and specialists support the parents and link up, and there's, you can see the link down there to Bronfenbrenner, if we can get that support right, we can actually really help develop the child as a sense of belonging and give them those core elements that they need. Now, if you look at the research, and you, most of us educationalists will know Piaget, we'll know Vygotsky, and we will have studied all of this, and I'm sure you all have. And they will say the most important stages are early childhood development. And George and Anna both mentioned this in terms of early childhood development, giving children the basis and the roots. And for all of those studies, if you look at them deeply, they talk about setting down strong foundations for children. Now, I have a friend who is an architect, and he was showing me the new designs for houses. And I have a house in England, and it's an old Victorian house. It's over 150 years old. And when you are digging foundations for an old house in those days, you would go down a meter, at least over a meter into the ground to get strong root foundations. Now, the designs that I was seeing of a friend who's just recently designing houses is they're not digging the foundations. They don't want these houses to last that long because no one knows what the future holds in terms of development and building materials. So he said, we want housing to be short term because housing will need to change and adapt. And I think that's a good analogy in terms of our children. We've been trying to look at Piaget's and Vygotsky's theories and saying we need to give these children grounding and roots. But in fact, if we think about it, what we are seeing an emerging group of people, and there's quite a large group, who've never had this, these grounded roots that Piaget and Vygotsky have been mentioning. And they've done quite well. And how do we now encapsulate what we're learning about this new group as emerging and give them the development and structure and support that and an identity that they need? And I think that's a key question for parents. How do we develop that? And as educationalists, do we recognize them first and foremost? We're recognizing that children with specific learning difficulties have learning difference, and there's an area of strength in there. Can we actually do the same for these children who are third culture kids? So we would now call these children what we call global nomads. And that question of who am I and where do I belong should really be about what do you bring to the world? Who are you? What have you learned? What are your experiences? Because they're incredibly valuable. And I know Deborah's nodding there, but there are some naivety aspects in there. We need to deal with those. And as educationists and parents, I'm sure we can. these children, and as you saw in the video, they say, we are so different. Yeah. I'm so different to my parents. I'm so different to other children within my school or my setting or my cousins. And it's the difference that we have been saying when dyslexia is so important. And this is the difference for these children, we should be saying is so important. And I think this is a good forum for us to start this sort of push a movement of consolidating, hey, we've got something very special here. And how do we support them? Now, I want to just go back to Erikson's and Piaget and Vygotsky and said that the parents' concern, and a lot of the parents will say, when I talk to them about third culture kids and the development, their biggest fear is, what will happen to my child if I don't get this right? And if they don't get the roots and if we don't get the development right early on, would this lead to them feeling not having a sense of belonging? Will they feel no roots? Could this lead to self-harm? Now, there's some studies have been done into this. And the good news is that we're finding in terms of the research, and there's a little bit of research, not a lot, but we need more in this area, that these children go, if we can get the support right, they go on to become pretty stable young people. And so there's a good news for parents, but the parents, the key aspect for parents is we've got to get this right and we've got to support them. So what can they do? How can they support their children? And one of the key things that they talk about is they talk about maintaining the traditions of where you could be from. So for example, my family, I have two daughters, they consider them third culture kids. I'm from India, so we visit India. My wife is Irish, so we visit Ireland. I grew up in England, so we visit England. And so we look at all three elements of where their identities come from. And we give them, and it's not always in equal measures. My wife seems to win that battle more than most, but so we try to give them as much support and exposure to those areas. So food, people have said food is important. So children say, well, this tastes like grandma's cooking, or these small adjustments and support really can make a difference. Supporting the children I support Coventry City Football Club. I know George is gonna laugh at that. So my children, like it or not, have to support Coventry City. And I know they're not top division team, but it's something that I can take them to a game and, you know, show them this is what I grew up and this is what I did. And I know it bores them silly, but it's something that they can then decide if they want to follow it up and take it on or not. At least you've done that as a part of exposure at an early stage. But the key aspects always has to be, when we're looking at supporting our children, is do we listen to them? Do we really know them? And that came throughout in the video that we showed at the beginning. And parenting styles is something that it's keys and aspects of it. So Deborah's gonna just put that up for me, please. Thank you, Deborah. See, I got my pleases and thank yous this time. Thank you, Deborah. Parenting styles is really important. And I think not just for third culture kids, rather than being authoritarian, and you've got the grid format there, which shows you the different types. And I see some parents who are uninvolved, and that tends to be where we see some of our expat families, where they are farming off the support of nurturing to nannies and maids. And this can be very detrimental. And so we want to try to avoid that. The other one is permissive, where they just give in, they give everything to the child, particularly if a child has a special need. And again, that's not great. Fortunately, I'm not seeing the authoritarian aspect as much as I used to, but depending on which culture they come from, I do say it does sometimes emerge in this region. But the one that we want to really look at is the authoritative. is the parents that actually are prepared to create a warm, nurturing environment, listen to their child, give them some element of autonomy, give them firm rules and boundaries, but give them a clear indication of why they're there. And particularly if you are in a new host country and their rules and regulations on maybe substance abuse are going to be very different to where you've come from, they really need to know this if they're teenagers. So there's some really, really important aspects, but parenting style will go a long way to support children who have a specific learning difficulty and who are third culture kids. And I'm going to go through then my next slide, please, Deborah. Is there, and I know, June, you're going to be talking about this. Third culture kids are emerging. They're a huge group, and they can be highly adaptable. They're independent. There are a lot of really good benefits of being a third culture child. And being in an international circuit, you get to make a lot of connections, as those kids in the videos showed us. And these are all incredibly important aspects of this new emerging group. So my last slide is some interesting facts. And the first one is that at this moment, I think we have about 230 million third culture kids. And that's a massive, massive in terms of countries or population. You know, we took all this Southeast Asia, not including China, obviously, but this is a big population. And when I'm recruiting, I often look for children who are third culture kids, because I know they're going to last in this region because they've experienced it. They've experienced change. They're not going to be missing home, their home country, because they've been moving around a lot. I've recruited quite a few people from the UK, and most of them will go back and the main reason they go back is that they miss their family. Hmm. Whereas when I've recruited third culture kids and they've come through the system here, they don't tend to have that because they tend to have the ability to develop those roots here and the connection.
Resilience, huh? Yeah.
Yeah, and resilience to it. Thank you, yeah, to that. So the next one is that in terms of the I know these are just, we can just flick, just start clicking them through, Deborah, please, all of them. And I think that the last two are very important. I think here,
it's 16 hours.
Okay, thank you. We've got here, these young people will go on to become highly qualified, and they'll go on, they're likely good to go in terms of postgraduates. So what we've got is a big group of really highly qualified, highly mobile, highly motivated, resilient people. And if parents can get the support right and we can look after them at the early stages and develop those links and support, we could actually have a very interesting future globally, where these young people could go on. And if you, it's interesting to see where they go, where the types of employments they're going to. And I found that self-employment and particularly working in NGOs is really, really encouraging. So I'm going to stop off on that note, I think. I've got a reference point as well on the last one, last slide. And it mentioned some of the things that Anna has already mentioned, some of the books that she's mentioned there. Okay, that's me done, I think.
Hey, Hashi, thank you so much. Wow, we are really...
Sorry, I went over a little bit, I think.
No, but we've got so much to talk about. We'll try and pack it in. Yeah, we try and pack it in. We try at the end of it to try and answer, go backwards and answer so that our other two panelists can have their moment to share on their topic. Let's move on to June. June, you're sharing with us on the benefits as well as the challenges of being a third culture child. And you yourself have a child that's a TCK.
Yes, I have three children. This is a constant struggle, I would say, when they, you know, sometimes I listen to the interactions with friends and they say things like, I live in Indonesia, I can speak Indonesian, but I am half American and half Singaporean.
How old are they?
The youngest is 10, the middle one is 12, and the eldest is 14. Mm. Yeah. So yeah, they do have issues like that that they talk about. Oh, maybe my friends don't really understand, you know. Harshi, I do agree with you about exposing kids to parents' culture as much as, you know, we want to, fly them to America and get them to interact with their cousins and their grandparents in America or their family in Singapore. But being children of teachers, a different kind of third culture kid here. There are many different kinds of third culture kid.
Yes,
we do have limitations of, we do have limitations. So here I'm going to be talking about variations of third culture kids. Ted Won in 1984 mentioned that he made a prediction that it would be a norm to grow up among different cultural worlds. And with increased globalization and mobility, we see many different kinds of people who will qualify as global nomads or cross-cultural kids, especially with now we have with conflict also, you can also see children of refugees falling into this category. Why am I talking about variations of third culture kids? It's because being in an international school, it's inevitable that they would also meet all these other variations of third culture kids, which may change their experience. It will definitely affect their experience as an international third culture student. Yep. All right, next slide, please. Okay, these are some of the benefits of being a third culture kid. These kids, they have seen places that others have only read and watched on TV, while some of my, some of my friends' children have read about or watched or they have learned about refugees or about poverty. My own children, my students who have actually seen these things firsthand, having lived in a different geographical location, having interacted directly with people who have been affected by conflict. So that enrich their outlook of the world. They have a very broad understanding of world issues. They are able to be flexible and cope with a lot of changes because having to move from one place to another, they have to adapt quickly and it's not easy, but they do it. Yeah, the challenge is real. And this is where we as parents and teachers will have to address some of the challenges that they're facing. Third culture kids, not only are they exposed to different issues, different world issues, they are also exposed to different cultures, practices. They might ask questions about sensitive questions about religion, sensitive questions about gender. And then as parents, how do you address that? As teachers in the classroom, how do you, address their curiosity? They can be an asset to the school and the classroom because they bring in all these different perspectives. I remember a couple of years ago, I had this student who was living in North Korea, and all the other children in the class, they were so curious about her. Yes, Deborah, I see your eyes going big. Yeah, they have only heard about North Korea from, what people say. And then now they have a classmate who's living there, and they get firsthand information about what life is like there. And it's quite interesting how they interact and add on to one another's experiences. Yeah. I'm going to give some examples of how third culture kids have contributed to Indonesia. These are Melati and Isabel Witchson. I'm sure there are some green school teachers in the audience. Big shout out for you guys. So Isabel and Melati Witchson, they founded Bye Bye Plastic Bags at the age of 10 and 12. So yeah, lots of these third culture kids, they are very involved in international issues. They are change makers as young as 10 and 12. What was I doing when I was 10 and 12? Yeah. So they came from Dutch and Indonesian parents, and they started an international youth movement to reduce plastic pollution. There is Bye-Bye Plastic Bag in Singapore and I think in many different parts of the world right now. And recently, Melati has represented Indonesia in the Cannes Film Festival in a documentary film called Bigger Than Us, produced by Marin Potia and directed by Flo Rasu. So there's international recognition there, yeah. And I, like I said, there are third culture kids who are children of diplomats. There are third culture kids who are children of teachers like me. And many years ago, I had this wonderful experience working with a great educator who brought her children to Indonesia. And she was concerned about her daughter not being able to speak her native language. But right now, that child is now in a university in the Philippines learning Mandarin. So imagine the wealth that she is bringing back to her home country just by, you know, having experienced a culture different than hers. Okay, I'm also going to talk about the characteristics and types of international schools. Well, there are so many different types of international schools around the world and with different curriculums. There are those doing IGCSE, IB, AP or the IPC. So as parents, I think if you are looking for an international school, you should also, this is to add on to what Anna mentioned earlier, what kind of curriculum do you think would best suit your own children? And then there are also overseas school that brings, you know, the overseas schools that bring foreign curriculum into another country, like the PSLE in Singapore. They now have an IPSLE, right? And in 2013, Hayden and Thompson identified three types of international school. The traditional international school that was set up for children of diplomats who travel from one country to another. And then there is the ideological international schools, maybe international schools that focus on sustainability or international mindedness. And then there are also other non-traditional market-driven kind of schools, either parents who want to bring their kids to expose their kids to an education system that they could not get in their local school system, or they want better opportunities for their children in terms of university admission. Yeah. So, So all these, knowing the different types of international schools will also be significant for students' well-being and development when you know what is appropriate or suitable for your children's education. So in this sense, understanding the culture of the school too, what kind of disciplinary policies they have. Do they have a restorative kind? Because we know sometimes our third culture children might get into, you know, issues with you know, behavior so what kind of approaches do the schools have to help the children overcome some of these challenges? All right. And being third culture children also, they have qualities of opposite ends, which you can see in the next slide. Okay, they do have identity issues, like home is everywhere, but also nowhere, as quoted by Mayberry in a BBC article. And they do experience loss and grief. Having left a certain place or a certain school, they sometimes don't have enough time to say goodbye to good friends and teachers. So how do you address you know, that grief? How do you support them in that social, emotional aspect? And making and keeping lasting friendships can be an issue because people keep coming and going. It may affect the way they form relationships in the future, and transitioning to the next destination or going back to their home country may, you know, make them feel super anxious, and Shilpa will be addressing that issue later. Okay, and in the next slide, you will see the juxtaposition concerning being third culture children. While they do have a large worldview, they may be unaware of their own culture. They may see very deep, you know, issues. They may see a 3D view of the world, but they also have seen a painful view of reality. Mm. They will be, you know, they are exposed to very deep questions, different perspectives of life. And they do have a huge network of friends, but they might not have many close friends, or they may avoid close relationships. They may be multilingual, especially at the young level. I can see my young son, he gets confused with all the different languages that he's able to speak. They may be adaptable to different situations, but they may not be able to fit in. Yeah, that is constantly an issue, a challenge for them. They have all these multifaceted identity, but at the same time, they do have an identity crisis. As Ashi mentioned earlier, who am I? Yeah. And while they do grieve, some of these grief may not be addressed, but they are also very resilient. Okay, so these are some of the qualities of third culture children, some of the benefits that they bring for themselves, for, you know, the area, the culture where they enter, and also the culture they come from. And these are also the challenges that they face. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, June, for your sharing. That was really insightful. And I think when our participants have time again, they can go through some of your points and reflect on them. Maybe just a very quick ask from the whoever one would like to answer in relation to third culture kids with learning differences. Can I know, like, sometimes the school counselor may not come to the attention of the school counselor that maybe this child is really struggling, you know, or adjusting. So within your own environment, maybe you could share how does this remedial, what do you do in your own setting? Who wants to try first? Hashi. Okay.
Can I? Yeah, look, it's a huge area. How do we support them? And George, is good. This is where it's quite difficult in some settings where we don't have the support structures of school counselors in place. When I first arrived out here, there were some schools, and there's still some schools who don't have those sort of support facilities. What I've done, and I've been quite savvy in trying to get support for these children, in Bangkok, we have some very good universities who are, you know, doing MAs and master's degrees and PhDs in counseling. So I went and visited them and said, look, what do you do with your placement students? So all of these PhD students, and so I get them to come and do their placements with me. And also I get them to, I try to find schools that need this support. And I put these students to do their placements there. And under the guidance of my organization and the UK university that I work with, we then sort of somehow do this counseling support, which doesn't cost very much because these people are doing their placements. And of course they get really good support from their university.
Yeah.
And we do, it's a really good way of getting support to those parents, and we do for parents and for children who really do need it, and it's vital. But I can understand, because George is nodding his head over there. It is incredibly difficult to get, and it can be very, very expensive to get the support. However, on the expense bit, if the parents are expats, I found that if you scrutinize their insurance policy, health insurance policies, you can usually find somewhere where you can get the budgeting for it.
True.
Look, these are all, you know, really, really important things to look at and support. But there are many ways, you know, as they say, George, in England, there's many ways to skin a cat.
Yes. Yeah. I certainly wasn't expected to hear that phrase, you know, like
what sort of cat?
In this context. But yeah.
How about you, George? What would you say on that?
Okay, some schools won't have counselors. Some schools won't have, or if they do have special needs people, you know, certainly 10 years ago, almost none of the international schools that I was looking at, I won't name the country, but the country that I was based in that time, none of the international schools, and I mean like the big player international schools, had a special needs department or anything like it. They had a counselor that was covering everything, primary and secondary, learning difficulties, everything, you know. It's definitely international schools were and remain a mixed bag. They're getting better, but I mean, most of them are getting better because they have to, because they have to comply. I'm not saying that's their only motivation, but you know, they have to comply if they're going to be part, you know, if they're going to be accredited by organizations like the Council of International Schools. Or the WASC, is it? Western American Schools and Colleges. You know, I'm not too sure about WASC, but I know that if you look at a school's, like what bodies it's accredited by, you know, those organizations will have statements about the school's duty to be inclusive. So, you know, I mean, it might be a bit daunting to go and look at their website and to, you know, hold the school accountable to what, you know, they're supposed to be doing. If you want help with that, get in touch with me. It's one of the great things about being, you know, from that sort of background, but, you know, I feel quite liberated now that I'm no longer working for a specific organization, you know, so I can, you know, I can tell you what the school's duties and responsibilities are according to their accrediting bodies anytime you like. Yeah. Sorry, I think that
went off. Sorry, Anna, you were mentioning sometimes these issues will not be noticeable to the counselors, but I believe that it is not just the responsibilities of the counselors to look out for these things. The teachers, you know, the whole community, even other parents, they can help out with this. Like Harshi, I think you were the one who mentioned it takes a village to raise a child. And and I think the most important thing is a school should have a social emotional needs program, because with a social emotional needs program, the child will feel safe And other children will also not be so harsh on them. And there is support when there is a curriculum like that embedded in whatever that the teachers are teaching.
You're absolutely right, June. I totally agree with you. You know, particularly, you know, if a student comes to a new school and they have a specific learning difficulty, the school knows about it. Quite often they won't educate the peers about it, which, you know, prior to the child joining the cohort, it's a sort of sink or swim attitude, which in this day and age, I don't think it's good enough at all, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think I think if you inform, educate the cohort prior to the child joining, then, you know, mm-hmm. children will step up, and, you know, they'll be more aware of their responsibility to somebody who has a learning difference if they realize that they're, mm-hmm. you know, somebody who that they can help in a practical way.
Yes.
And that, you know, like, for example, problematic behavior or challenging behavior, they can see it through that, just a little bit through that lens, then, you know, mm-hmm. it can make all the difference for everyone.
I know, as a parent of children with learning differences going into an international school, I have a big responsibility to make sure, oh, someone's calling me, oh my goodness, I have a big responsibility to make sure that I do my role in making sure I support the school and help them. You know, we're in partnership together, and to make sure that, you know, both the school and I are on the same page when it comes to supporting my child. So, and I believe there's a lot of amazing learning support people out there, but, you know, they are stretched. You know, they don't have the government support behind them to make sure they have enough teachers within the school to be able to support the kids that come. You know, our students with learning differences have parents who are with learning differences. And the reason why they are global nomads is because they are an amazing set of people. You know, they're very, very talented. But, you know, as our children grow up, they go through that struggle. You know, they're not adults yet. You know, when they become adults, they're just amazing kids. But, you know, it's this struggle that they go through initially that it's really challenging for everyone, you know. So
very often unnecessary, I would say, you know.
Agreed.
If a school is properly, you know, planning, thinking, taking its responsibilities seriously, yeah, and they involve the parents and the, you know, the learning support people, the counselors or whatever, in a proper way from the outset, and, you know, then a lot of the issues that do occur can be avoided.
I think teacher training is also something that, you know, yeah, empowering the teachers as well to know how to support students with different learning differences.
That's sure. Right, Anna. I mean, like in countries like the US, UK, Singapore, we do have some regulations about teacher training and professional development. There are requirements for that, but I can't say the same for, you know, different places. There are different cultures when it comes to education. So, yeah.
Singapore is very active on that part, I must say. And especially DAS Academy, like, because I'm working with DAS, so I have noticed that we are quite, there is, you know, regular training going on. Yes, we know our stuff. We have been teaching. We, of course, know what we are doing. The knowledge is there, but I'm sure everybody needs to update that over a certain period. And Academy is doing just fantastic job. And, you know, we also, like, I got myself trained in educational psychology. So which kind of gives me a different perspective when I'm teaching my child. I'm just not looking at what I'm academic part of it. So yeah. So shall I start?
Yes, Shilpa, yeah, you're next.
Thank you. Yes.
So yeah. We conclude our discussion with Shilpa today, and she's gonna take us through moving back to your own country or to another country. Over to you,
Shilpa. Yeah, hi. Yeah, after listening to all of them, you know, and what we know of third culture kids, it just keeps coming into my mind that change is the only constant, you know, that Greek philosopher said. And it's so true about these children, especially. They are facing the changes all the time. And like Harshi said, yeah, they are very resilient. Even all through this, they learn to face whatever challenges come their way. And but having said that, okay, I'm going to start with, you know, when I was going to speak about it, I interviewed three of my students, okay? Two are teenagers and one is much younger, like 9-year-old. So when I asked the 9-year-old, okay, suppose if your mom and dad decide to move back home. So she just looked at me with such a blank stare she gave me and she said, so I am at home. This is home for me. I said, okay, fine. So, you know, probably what I thought was, maybe even if they move at that age, children probably adjust and adapt much easier because they're younger, it's easier to find friends. But when I posed it to my two 17-year-olds, they looked at me like, what, you're out of your mind? We are not moving anywhere. So I said, yeah, but in case you have to move. So then they came back with very good feedback, you know. So a Japanese student told me that, you know what, I'm quite familiar with all my culture, my like Japanese customs and everything, because I've seen it on the TV or I've read about it, but I don't know how much I'll be able to adapt if I move back. Food is fine because we eat our traditional food, but otherwise I'm very Singaporean. That was the statement. Another Canadian boy, he said the same thing. He said, what home? Yeah, maybe some point in time I'll be going there for university, but I still consider Singapore as my home. So he said everything. For me, chicken rice is more important than whatever the dish you eat in Canada, you know. So I said, okay. So, you know, but other things which we spoke about, like, you know, I'll come to that when I talk about what tips we can do. So what happens, like here I said, the title is moving back to home country, but we can also say that moving countries, because the same grief, same problems, yeah, they are going to face. But why I mentioned, and I purposely gave these two, whatever, these cartoons kind of things, that was the reaction. What? No. That is the reaction when I said home country. So home is only home to their parents, yeah? So that is what these boys also told me. He said, yeah, our parents consider that as home. Same thing happens with my own kids who have grown up here practically. Now, and they both are in two different countries. One is in Australia, one is in the US. So when I say, let's move back home. So they said, yeah, probably India is home for you, but they can't bring themselves to say, call that as home. You know, it's very difficult for them to, because my son speaks, he learned fluent Mandarin, he can speak. My daughter can speak French, but at the same time, they speak both the local languages, regional languages, which we speak in India. They can speak Hindi, the two local languages we speak. But again, having said all that, somewhere they already are apprehensive about certain things. And I'm talking about two grown-up adults. I'm not even talking about school children. So, you know, we can say, yeah, what they, when our TCKs, I don't like to call them TCKs, actually, more of these global kids, you know, these global culture kids, when they move, they may face difficulties adapting socially. Already all of them have spoken about it, you know. Academically, the reason is the system can be different. The teaching style methods can be different, yeah? So that they might have to face. Another one, which I have always faced with my students, they always talk about it, is second language. So if they are doing Malay, or not Malay usually, they'll be doing French, Spanish, Chinese here. And suppose they're supposed to take another second language. For a child with learning differences, that can be a big challenge. And then we don't know if they, like in Singapore local school, they can get the exemption, right, for second language if you have a report on dyslexia, whatever. But they're not sure if that can happen in their home country. Another thing is fear of being judged by relatives. Yes, I mentioned it here, and I definitely will say it is always there. The reason is when they visit for holidays, it's all rosy. It's all very nice. They go, everybody like entertains them. And you know what? Oh, wow, these kids are staying outside and this and that. But when it comes to moving permanently, then all the major issues begin. Like you are going to start schooling. People are going to ask you how you perform in school, you know, academically. that's going to happen. If it is an Asian country, God help them. That's going to be worse. Yeah, that's everybody is going to ask. So I feel the judgment definitely is an issue, because I have spoken to all my students over the period of time, and this is why I have written here. Unfamiliarity with customs and traditions, but that's okay. What Shaharshi had come up with the point, I like that, because, you know, you just keep cooking traditional food, or, you know, get them kind of familiar with that. So they're not so lost on that. That can be done. Another thing which the expectations and how to deal with them, in the sense how to, there are certain behavioral norms in certain cultures, you know, and our kids are grown up. Now my kids have grown up outside India all along. Now, I have taught them. I have taught them traditions, but somewhere I think they are a little scared if they are missing out on something when they meet elders, or, you know, if people will misjudge them. Another thing is, why did I mention this dual stress? At the moment, I am teaching a child whose mom moved back, and there was she was a divorced mom, and she is going through a lot of adjustment issues. And although Singapore is home for her, but she is kind of trying to adjust. She keeps complaining that there is not enough support. What do I do? How do I work with him? So that's where I think this is another issue. Luckily, the child is small. He misses his father. But I think if it's a teenager, the reaction might be even stronger, because the teenagers are dealing with their own emotional issues. And if they have to deal with this, it's not going to be very helpful. Deborah, we can go to the next slide, please. Can we move? Thank you. So yeah, a little positive which I saw, like right now, you know, COVID is all over, like nothing else. COVID has become a life, unfortunately, for all of us. But what I noticed during this COVID, like a couple of my students, they had to move countries, and the date kept getting postponed because, yeah, there was some visa issue. The other person who was going to replace the dad couldn't come in. So they were supposed to move in June, and they're still here. It's October already. So what happened was, the schools had started. So this child started already the school, you know, with online lessons and all that. And we realized that she started feeling very comfortable because she's seeing all her classmates, and she's seeing her teacher every day. And it's a proper routine, discipline, the classes are going on. So what came to my mind, like I have suggested, and we are trying it out, that, you know, it's not only academics when they move, right? It's not only the learning. They need to know all the other aspects of life, what they're going to face when they move finally. So the buddy system, that's where we thought that if the teacher can appoint a friend, a child, another student from the class as a buddy, and of course, under the, as I said, supervision of teacher and the parent, that what they are exchanging, what messages are being exchanged, because that is another risk. If they just, you know, that I felt, so it's working somehow, like the girl has opened up, because this girl, she threw a huge tantrum. I remember there was a huge meltdown that why do we have to leave Singapore? Now, the whole, this thing had changed. I can see that. So I felt that, you know, so this will help to connect this new entrant to the his or her peers, you know, like, and it's a kind of, it helps the acclimatization process, which is going to be, which is going to make this physical move easier. Because when they land there, everything is not going to be totally unknown or whatever, you know, they would have seen the faces of the friends, they know the teacher, they know the way they are taught, basically, they know the method, you know. So I think, and already they know about the activities, online buddy, I felt that the activities, what children, there is that local slang, you know, the way they speak. I think it's very important for teenagers, especially. Like if they belong, the sense of belonging starts building up, you know. So I felt that for our TCK and someone with learning difference, you know, who is already, they know that somewhere the struggle will be there. So that is going to help. The online buddy system will help. And this is what I say, that this will help the child to overcome the shyness, because shyness and apprehension is definitely going to be there, especially the teenagers. I have a boy who keeps worrying about how he looks. how the people are going to judge him just by his looks. How many times I have to tell him that you're so smart, you're so good at it. But unfortunately, they tend to look at their physical features more at that age, right? So image is an issue, which I feel that if they have buddy system and if they do online classes, it will take away a bit of an edge from that. So overall, I think after this, I feel that it will help build self-esteem to a certain extent and definitely a solid foundation for new beginning when they land there physically. So our the child with learning difference, when he lands, it's not going to be like, oh my God, what are they going to think of him? They already know him. Okay, he learns this way. So he already knows the learning support person. The learning support person has already warmed up. Hopefully the rapport is so important, you know, with these kids. So this is what. Deborah, can move to the next slide, please. Thank you. So this is what I thought. They take a flight if we move them, you know. Let's make that flight easier for them. So how can we make that easier? Already a few points have been mentioned. I remember Hershey said that June also spoke about it. Like keep in touch with their, specifically I said cousins matter when you move back because I think you have to kind of socialize. Then their old friends, if there are family friends whom they're familiar with, whom they meet during holidays, keep in touch as much as possible. So of course, to find a school with good learning support, I specifically put in there, I know a school in Singapore, they have one counselor for two campuses. Doesn't work. It is so difficult, you know, it is so difficult. I have had students from that school and I'm lost because there is no proper assessment report. There is no guidance. So I think finding a right school with the right learning support and being very open and frank with learning support about the difficulties your child is facing. I have heard parents saying, no, he's just lazy, actually. That's why he is not able to do that. Never, never do that. If you have identified, if you have faced it, if you have seen your child is struggling, then if the assessment has not been done before, please, better to be honest, please open up with the learning support. They are the ones who are going to help the student more than anyone else in this world. So then another thing, check out if there are any organizations who can offer out-of-school extra support, just like ours, Dyslexia Association. We are doing a lot of work. I mean, I genuinely mean that we are, because sometimes they don't have enough learning support in school, or sometimes it is curriculum-based remediation, where someone like me, if a ninth grader is struggling with the math, so they can take that extra support with me and I can help fill in the gaps, being at the same time being very aware of the emotional status. Okay, Deborah, I'm coming to the end.
Thank you.
Yeah. And just one more suggestion I would have to the parents is that, you know, continue that remote learning support with your previous learning support person or whoever is doing that work. So when they move, some familiarity will remain. You don't make it completely new for that child. I'm doing it for a couple of my students already. And it works wonders. And they have given me that feedback that they want it that way. And of course, this is one of the important points, that available time period you can use. How? You can order the textbooks if you know what system the child is going in. We have done that and it works. It works wonderfully because already the child is becoming, if there are no online classes, order those books, start getting the child familiar to that. So, you know, that's it. Sympathy, non-judgmental treatment of the child and taking a few steps will definitely help this process to become smoother. Thank you, Deborah. I have rushed.
Thank you so much.
Sorry, this is such an ambitious topic.
Yeah. I know.
In the time that we said,
maybe we'll do a part two. Give me the thumbs up and I can organize a part two.
Part two, I think, is definitely important.
Oh, yeah. Excellent. Thank you so much.
George and I are giving two thumbs ups.
Yes,
George.
Yes. Great. So I'm afraid we've come to the end. We're out of time. Deborah, any other slide to show? No, nothing? No?
The only thing was the pledge.
Part two from a panelist.
But what we'll do is we'll share the slide deck with everyone who has attended.
Let's do.
And so that you have all the information, because we shared so much today.
Yeah, that's right.
And honestly, we have a lot of more personal experiences that we do want to share today.
Lots of people want us to do part two. That's very nice.
Good. So
we'll charge them next time. Sorry.
Because so much of us, we have so much to share. I think we should definitely do a part two. And we'll see when these guys are available so we can have a discussion.
Yeah, we will.
Yeah. One of the things to support our community in all countries around the world, DAS has started up a petition or a pledge. Just sign the pledge and show your support for the dyslexic or learning differences community. That would be great. But yeah, we've run over time, guys.
Yes.
And,
so
it was very, very, very interesting.
Very good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone. I'd like to thank our panelists today, really, from the bottom of my heart. Very grateful for your time, giving up your precious time to join us today, and for such an insightful, enriching, lively, you know, heartwarming, coming from your own direct experiences is the best, right? So thank you once again. And it's in a way so nice as a community, you know, as Hashi was saying, we share and we learn from each other, you know, through the experiences. All right, so wishing everyone here, participants, panelists, a safe space for you and your family. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Anna.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lovely seeing all of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we say goodbye, and we will be in touch with you by email, because we all love your feedback. And stay tuned for episode 2.
Okay.
Bye, guys. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye. Bye.